1 Timothy chapter 3, starting at verse 1.
It is a trustworthy statement. If any man aspires to the office of overseer, it is a fine work he desires to do. An overseer, then, must be above reproach, the husband of one wife, temperate, prudent, respectable, hospitable, able to teach, not addicted to wine or pugnacious, but gentle, uncontentious, free from the love of money. He must be one who manages his own household well, keeping his children under control with all dignity. But if a man does not know how to manage his own household, how will he take care of the church of God? Not a new convert, lest he become conceited and fall into the condemnation incurred by the devil. He must have a good reputation with those outside the church, so that he may not fall into the reproach and the snare of the devil. Deacons likewise must be men of dignity, not double-tongued or addicted to much wine, or fond of sordid gain, but holding to the mystery of the faith with a clear conscience. Let these also first be tested, then let them serve as deacons, if they are beyond reproach. Women must likewise be dignified, not malicious gossips, but temperate, faithful in all things. Let deacons be husbands of only one wife, and good managers of their children and their own households. For those who have served well as deacons obtain for themselves a high standing and great confidence in the faith that is in Christ Jesus. I am writing these things to you, hoping to come to you before long. But in case I am delayed, I write so that you may know how one ought to conduct himself in the household of God, which is the church of the living God, the pillar and support of the truth. And by common confession, great is the mystery of godliness. He who was revealed in the flesh was vindicated in the spirit, beheld by angels, proclaimed among the nations, believed on in the world, and taken up in glory. When Pastor Paul asked me to read and comment on one verse, I thought, really? One verse? I chose verse 6, and which we'll go over now again. Not a new convert, lest he become conceited and fall into the condemnation incurred by the devil. Now, if we look at what the devil did to incur the condemnation of God, it's a fascinating thing to consider that the devil took time to look at himself and to be impressed. Now, angels are created beings. Humans are created beings. The devil had nothing to do with how God made him. We have nothing to do with how God made us. It's what he did. It's how he created us. It's what he accomplished. It's not something we did. I want to ask you a question. I think that almost all of us can probably agree on this point, which is not an easy thing in Christianity, to all agree on one point. Do we really think that God wants us to focus our attention on ourselves? Does anybody think that? See, oftentimes we think that pride has to do with thinking of ourselves as this high and lofty thing, which is what the devil did. Because the truth was, God made him impressive. But I think it's more about thinking about ourselves that's the problem. Because Jesus tells us, one place he tells us, take no thought for our life. Now consider that for a minute. No thought? I mean, I don't know about you, but I take a lot of thoughts for my life. He also tells us to set our mind on things above, not on things that are on the earth. So when we look at what happened with the devil, God created hell, not for you and I. He created hell for the devil and his angels. Why? Because they focused on themselves. They focused on what they wanted in life. And I would encourage us to recognize it's the focus on ourselves that's the problem. That's pride. It's thinking about me. It's not necessarily thinking highly about me. You can be just as proud thinking lowly of yourself, because the truth is, you still have no say in who you are and who God made you to be. God wants us to focus on Him, because He is the one that created a new life in us as believers. He is the one that gave us new life through His Spirit. He is the one that has taken our old life and hidden it Himself. It's not about us. It's about what He's doing in us. And when it's about what He's doing in us, there's no place for pride. There's no place for even thinking about ourselves. What we're going to eat, what we're going to drink, what we're going to wear, as Jesus said. There's no place for it because it's His life in us. It's not ours anymore at all, even a little. I had a friend, I went to Bible college years ago, and my roommate is a pastor down in Indiana, and we were talking on the phone years after we graduated from college, and I was talking about this concept that God had been showing me about pride and about us thinking about ourselves and that we really can't take credit for anything. And he's like, "We can't take credit for anything?" And he was just expressing what most of us think. That, can't we take, get a little glory out of this deal? And the truth is, no. And the greatest example of a lack of pride is our Lord Jesus Christ. Hebrews, it tells us that when everything's said and done, when the world's all destroyed and He's created a new heaven and a new earth and everything is started over and every knee will bow at the name of Jesus, Jesus is going to take all that glory and give it to the Father, not taking any credit on Himself. If Jesus can take no credit, if Jesus can take no thought for His life, how can we?
Let's have a word of prayer and begin. Our God, we pray that You would give us attentive ears to hear from Your word on this Lord's Day morning, this celebration of Your resurrection. We remember You and we love You. And in keeping with what we've just heard, we consciously choose to take our eyes and our minds off of ourselves and we place them on You where they belong, and we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. The Church of Jesus Christ is very precious to Jesus. So precious, He wants her to be washed and made pure and devoted entirely to Him. In the New Testament, we find many instructions about the Church. In this book of 1 Timothy, we find an entire book of instructions about what would be pleasing to Jesus concerning the church. Paul wrote this book of 1 Timothy to Timothy, who was then serving at that time in pastoral ministry in the church in Ephesus. And the instructions are given in a number of areas. Instructions about defending the gospel, about Christian worship, about church leadership, about false teaching, instructions about social responsibility and personal responsibility. The theme of chapter 3 is about the selection of elders and of deacons to be serving in the church. And this chapter contains a list of qualifications which will be used by the church as a guideline for choosing capable men to serve. And I'm going to say something now at the outset of our meeting, at the outset of this sermon, that will come back again because it's really significant. I want you to know this. Entrusting God's work to ungodly men will yield ungodly results. Paul is writing Timothy and says, you're going to need to stand fast against false teachers in the church and people of wrong things they're doing. And he would say to them, if you give over the leadership and the teaching to ungodly men, it will bring about ungodly results. Does everyone understand this? When people look around at churches and they say, these churches have done things that have been either false in their teaching or damaging to others, it's not Jesus who has done that. It is ungodly people who are entrusted with God's work who've done this. Is this correct? And so ungodly work, or excuse me, God's work given to ungodly men will bring about ungodly results. Therefore, it's going to be significant for Paul to say, these are the qualifications for those who are going to be serving the body of Christ. And we're going to walk through those today. Daniel, I could use your help. My monitor needs help. All right? Now, we come to the first part of our message, qualifications for overseers. And we begin this way. Here is a trustworthy saying. Those are the first words that Paul gives here. And I want you to know, when Paul writes to Timothy, several times in his writings to Timothy, he says that phrase, here is a trustworthy saying. In other words, he is telling them, here is something that everyone should take to heart. Are you listening? In chapter 1, we saw one of these. It said, here is a trustworthy saying that deserves full acceptance. Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners, of whom I am the worst. Is that a good statement? Jesus came to be a savior of sinners, and I am in need of a savior because of my sin. You all got this? If everyone memorized that and repeated that on an hourly basis, we'd have something really straight. This is something God says is a really trustworthy saying that everyone should take to heart. You got this? Our need for a Savior is emphasized here. Now he comes to chapter 3. Here is a trustworthy saying. If anyone sets his heart on being an overseer, he desires a noble task. This is interesting. He says, here's another trustworthy saying, and this one isn't about our sin. This one is instead about something else. If you set your heart on being an overseer, that's a noble task. What is he saying? As I see it, this is a statement that says that people should grow to maturity. Do you got this? If you are a sinner who is saved by Jesus Christ, the next thing is to say, I want to grow up in my faith. And everyone should desire that. What is going to happen here in this chapter is going to be a list of qualifications for those who would be serving or leading. And that list of qualifications, I don't want you to think of as, that's something unique to Mr. Hoppy, but not to me. Because God says, I want you, young person, I want you, new Christian, to set your heart on having these kind of qualities in your life so that you would be also qualified to serve Jesus Christ. Do you understand this? These are what one person has called marks of maturity. This is what a mature believer looks like. And Christians should be growing up. It should be that all over the body of Christ, everyone except perhaps the very newest believers should have these kinds of marks of maturity. God wants us to grow up. Do you all got this? So I don't want you to think of this as merely being about others who are leaders, but it's what he wants all of us to aspire to. Although I should say that no one is going to be a shepherd of God's flock if he fails to have these qualities. Do you got this? All right then, so this is a trustworthy saying that everyone would be rightly growing up into this and that to desire this, to desire to have these kinds of ways that you are serving the Lord is a good thing. It's a noble thing, it says. God sees that as noble in his sight. Well, Timothy is going to need to learn to discern which ones are going to be chosen to lead and which ones aren't and how he's going to choose ones who are going to be elders and who are going to be deacons. And so Paul gives some words about this. He says, now the overseer must be above reproach. We're here in verse 2, the overseer must be above reproach. Someone might say, well, what is an overseer? Well, it's really just what it sounds like. It's someone who oversees the message of the church, the ministry of the church. Do you got this so far? In other translations, and maybe in your translation, it uses sometimes a different word, the word bishop, rather than overseer. Same thing. A bishop or an overseer is meant to be somebody who in the local church is overseeing the work of the church. There was another word that was used interchangeably with this word bishop or overseer, which was the traditional Jewish word, and that Jewish word was the word elder, meaning the one who was responsible for guiding the community of Jewish people in their worship. And so the word elder is sometimes used. Also, the word shepherd is sometimes used of what the role is for these men, and by extension, the word shepherd fits in with the word pastor. The word pastor means shepherd. So, interchangeably in the New Testament, those who are guiding or leading the church are sometimes referred to as overseer or bishop or elder or pastor or shepherd. And the point here, listen, the point is not so much what name you call it. Of greater importance is assuring that only those who are qualified are doing this work. Let me make this very clear. This is God's work, and shepherding eternal souls who are of immense worth is not something that is to be done falsely. Does everyone understand this? If I came to you and said, you wouldn't mind if I, borrowed $100,000 from you and used it in any way I chose, you would stop and say, yeah, I would mind. I'm kind of careful about my $100,000, is what you would say. Is this true? Friends, listen. The $100,000 is nothing compared to the worth of one eternal soul. You all know that, don't you? To have somebody who is now being asked to shepherd eternal souls in the life of the Church of Jesus Christ, which Jesus loves, is something that is very, very sensitive, important. It's something that is not meant to be done in a wrongful way. And so there are going to be qualities listed about who this may be. The first of those qualities, now the overseer, verse 2, must be above reproach. This phrase, above reproach, does not quite mean that this is one who is sinless in all that he ever does, because if that were the case, who would qualify other than Jesus himself and no one else? Do you understand that? But what it does mean is that we're talking about somebody who does not need correction in his character, where we don't come alongside of him and say, you need this to be corrected in your life. Moreover, it's not something where anyone can say, I know him personally, and I would object to him being ones to minister to others on the grounds of this, 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 or this. Do you understand what I'm saying? This is one big overarching quality. It is, the rest of the list would be individual things, but the one biggest thing is someone who is above reproach, where I could go and talk to his mother, and I could talk to his neighbor, and I could talk to his coworker, and I could talk to his wife, and I could talk to his children, and I could talk to the people that he knows closely, and they would say, I would support that. That would be a really good idea. He is one who is above reproach. And now we come to a list of some other qualities that come next. Starting in verse 2, the husband of but one wife. What is this teaching us? It's not so much a requirement that he must be married, or for that matter, a requirement that he must be unmarried. There have been churches in the past that have gotten confused on this. And some have said, leadership within the church requires marriage. And others say, no, it requires being unmarried. Paul himself says, I'm not married, and this is a blessing to me. Peter is married, and that's something God is using. Do you understand this? God says that that isn't the issue. But men, what is the issue? A more literal translation is something like this, a one-woman man, somebody who in his relationships concerning marriage or concerning relations with women is entirely trustworthy and dedicated to the one that God gave him. Do you get this? So physically and emotionally and spiritually, he's a one-woman man. He's committed to the one that God has given him, whether he's presently married or whether he's not married, but maybe married one day, and he remains faithful to that one he may marry someday. Do you get this? This is the kind of man that God says is qualified to serve in this way. Next, he's one who is temperate. Very literally, the word means not mixed with wine, is what this word means. It came to mean in time something like sober-minded or clear-minded or not given to confused thinking. Someone who is going to be leading others has to be not confused himself. A third qualification, this is what's listed next, self-controlled. It means self-disciplined. No one should lead others who cannot govern himself. Next, respectable. The word literally means with modesty, which I take to mean something like this, that instead of him having to project how wonderful he is so the people will listen to him, he can humbly do what he's supposed to do, and they would recognize that he is worthy of honor. The next one, hospitable. Hospitable. When I think of hospitable, at least when I was younger, I would think of somebody who had oven mitts and would bake things and would bring it out and put warm apple pies in front of people. And if elders bake warm apple pies, I'm not opposed to that. But the idea here is something like this. This is not something that is done when everybody's together and somebody's standing up front and you say, I am an elder, I've given a word, it's all over. Instead, you want to share your life with others. You want to love people so much, you bring them into your home. And the greatest teaching that is done is oftentimes around your dining room table and in your living room as you're having devotions with your family and one-on-one on the couch as you're praying with this one. Someone who is to be nurturing eternal souls cannot be someone who fails to love people and want to have them close to him in his own home. And that brings us to the next thing, too, because listen, so many of the things in Paul's day and frankly in our church happen in relation to meetings in the home where an elder would say something like this, won't you all come to my home and we are going to have a time of Bible study and prayer together as a hope group and I have something to teach you here. We're going to meet together in my home and I realize that people when they come, some of the furniture will get broken and there's going to be wear and tear on the carpet and there's going to be a lot of noise and confusion, but I love people so much. I want them to be here so that we can as a group come together in my home and I can teach them. And that naturally brings us to the next qualification here, and that's verse 2. They are able to teach. And this is significant. An elder guards the truth and teaches it to others. It's not one who's simply willing to teach. I know of men who are willing to talk at length, but no one has ever learned anything. That's not what we're talking about. God has supernaturally given this one the ability to not only talk, but people are learning. He is able to teach with effectiveness. And that teaching with effectiveness is happening sometimes one-on-one, sometimes in groups, oftentimes in groups in his home. Occasionally, it happens that it is in a group that is much larger. The New Testament church is portrayed as something where in Jerusalem, they got together in large numbers, and the apostles taught in crowded numbers in the temple courts, and they broke up into homes, and they were all through the homes, sharing meals, praying with each other, teaching the truth there. All of this is something that elders are responsible for, is doing this teaching of others. They are able to teach. Now in verse 3, not given to much wine. I've gotten ahead of myself somehow. Here we go. Not given to much wine. I think the text, as we heard it from Mr. Kissling, not addicted to wine. And I'll say something about that if I could. We've already heard that such a man is to be temperate, that is, not mixed with wine. And we see that that wasn't merely figurative, like he was to be clear thinking, but it's also to be a reality. Because intoxication destroyed lives then, and intoxication destroys lives now. And elders should neither risk such destruction for themselves, nor set a wrong example for such destruction to others. And now we come on to our next qualification, not violent. In some ways, that naturally follows this thing about drinking and addictions, because the two, addictions and violence, sometimes go together. But I would say this, in every circumstance, the man must not be controlled by anger or by verbal strife or by threats or by physical abuse. Do you get this? not in the home, not with others. He is a man who has a gentleness that is under control. And speaking of gentleness, that's the next of these things. He's patient and loving in response to people. When provoked by people or provoked by Satan, what emerges would be the Spirit of Christ. Our next quality, not quarrelsome. I want to make this very clear. Timothy was asked to stand firm in the truth. Elders are asked to stand firm in the truth. This does not mean that they're going to give ground on this. But an elder has no license to be unkind or destructive to others, even those who are opposing him. Did you understand that? Not a lover of money. Here it touches on his attitude toward money, and I would say this. What a man is about his money tells you what he is in relation to God in this respect. Everything we are belongs to God. Everything. If a man says, my income and my investments and my assets are mine, then we have idolatry in his life. If he says they are God's, and if he wants to use them in any way he chooses, it's all his, then we know we have somebody who's not functioning with that idol in his life. And I can tell you, many spiritual leaders have stumbled on this point. He is to manage his own family well, it says in verses 4 and 5. Let's take a look and actually read. It says, he must manage his own family well and see that his children obey him with proper respect. Verse 5, if anyone does not know how to manage his own family, how can he take care of God's church? You see, his family is his primary congregation. I tell young fathers, I even tell young husbands, I say to them, you now have a shepherding and a pastoring responsibility with your wife. And you have your own congregation. It's now a congregation of one or two, if you think of yourself. You have your own little congregation. And in time, that begins to grow. And he has several children. His congregation's getting a little bit bigger. If he is not succeeding in nurturing his wife and his children, not succeeding in bringing them up in a way where they say, I want to follow in his footsteps in the faith, I want to come under his direction and discipline, then you don't want to take this one and say, let's have him spread more of this unrest with others. Did you all understand this? The first training ground of this is in his own household, with his own family. What I wrote down here is, if he's not effective in bringing discipline to his children and causing them to walk in his footsteps, it is a bad idea for him to be entrusted with more people where he will likely produce the same bad results. Verse 6, not a recent convert. Literally, the word is not newly planted. Not newly planted. I can tell you this. If I come up to a tree, almost nothing bad is going to happen to the tree unless I've got a chainsaw. I can step on the tree, climb the tree. Nothing bad is going to happen. But if I come to a little seedling, and it's newly planted, and it's just beginning to grow, and if I step on it, something not good is going to happen. It says, he must not be a new convert, newly planted. It says, through pride or instability, he may fall. And may fall so far as to be working for Satan rather than working for God as a result. This is the verse that Mr. Kissling was focusing on. It says, he may become conceited and fall under the same judgment as the devil, and he would be resembling Satan and working for Satan rather than resembling Christ and working for Christ. He must, verse 7, have a good reputation with outsiders, so that he will not fall into disgrace and into the devil's trap. What do we mean by this? If I am doing an investigation of somebody who is being considered as an elder, it would be well for me to know, what is his reputation at work? What's his reputation with his neighbors? Do they say that he is one who is genuine, consistent? Is he somebody who's compassionate, generous? Or would they say something else about him? You see, he is in some ways going to be the face of the Church of Jesus Christ. And if the outsider says, I wouldn't ever want that because I know him, now we've got a problem. I want you to notice that verse 6 said he might fall under the same judgment as the devil. And verse 7 said he might fall into the devil's trap. Can I make something very clear to you? Satan is a very real enemy of our souls. In 1 Peter chapter 5, it said Satan goes about like a roaring lion looking for someone to devour. Some of you may say, well, Satan apparently bothers other people, but he doesn't bother me much. The very fact that you don't think he bothers you much tells me that you are oblivious to what Satan is doing. He is interested in devouring you. Can I say this again? Listen, church, he wants to destroy you. Did everyone catch this? Let's try this one more time. Kiddos and big people, Satan wants to destroy you. It's saying you can take somebody who looks like he might be leadership material, and he looks like things are going great in his life, and Satan may get a hold of his life and bring destruction to him and his family. Did you understand all that? That is serious stuff. What is more, that same text, 1 Peter chapter 5, says that we are like sheep who are in danger of a Satan who would want to destroy us, and we have a great shepherd, Jesus Christ, who is the one who cares for our souls, and that great shepherd on certain occasions designates certain ones that he has supernaturally chosen and equipped to assist him in that work as under-shepherds, ones who will be those shepherds, pastors, elders, teachers, who will do this work. And can I tell you something? And I say this without any hesitation. You need such shepherding from Jesus Christ primarily, and you need such shepherding from the pastoral care of wise and godly elders in a church setting. Jesus has designed it so. This is something that is right. Now, what I will tell you is this. It's interesting to me that it says, this is the character quality of those who will be shepherds, who will be elders, who will be overseers of the church. It does not say, and here are the seven steps for how we select and ordain these ones to do the work. Do you understand that? And that's typical of the Bible. The Bible frequently says, this is the truth, and then the Lord allows some latitude for one congregation or another based on its own needs for how it's going to handle this. For those who are interested, I'm going to give a one-minute summary of how our church applies this. In our own church, we believe it is right to have godly elders. Those who are currently serving as elders, from time to time, may, through prayer, sense that God may have a certain man among us who may be called to serve in that way. And the elders will, if they're in agreement about this, approach that man and say, is this something that you would consider? The one who's considering that is encouraged to consider it along with his family. I can tell you this, if his wife or older children said, Dad, I don't see that, then I don't want it either. You understand that? We're looking for something where we have that kind of quality in the home and in every other setting. So there's some discernment going on about that. If that one says, I am prepared to serve my family and I believe this is something that may be God's calling in this way, what would happen next is that the congregation as a whole would be advised that this is under consideration. The congregation would be asked to do prayer to discern and, frankly, any kind of a questioning or investigation of their own that they'd like to do. They may talk with that man. What are your beliefs or your practices on this? They might talk to that man. If they want to, they can call his mother and ask how he's doing in his life. Whatever you'd like to do, we'd say we're going to just fan out, make sure we're clear on this. And then there would be a time as a church meeting when we would gather together for prayer with those who are members of the church and come to a conclusive decision. Is this something that God would do? And if it is, well, then we would have that one become yet another elder in our church. And I can tell you this. My experience has been that when there have been ones who have become elders, God widens the capacity of such a man in the following way. Whereas he had care for his own wife and children and perhaps care for some who are in a hope group or some other smaller setting, now He is aware that he has care and responsibility for what in our church has become several hundred people, and God begins to give him insight and a heart for many. Did you understand this? And so that's how we've handled that, the kind of steps we would take in broad terms for having someone become such an elder in the life of our church. I am thankful for the men who serve as elders in our church. And now something about deacons. Deacons, likewise, verse 8, it says, what are deacons? Very literally, a deacon is a servant or one who serves. That's what the word means. One who serves, and there's not a list of job descriptions where it says deacons are the ones who mow the lawns and they're the ones who fix the roof of the building. It doesn't say anything like that. Instead, it's ones who are serving the work of the church. Let me give you an example. In the early church, there was a time when some of the widows were in need of meal deliveries, and the apostles said amongst themselves, it wouldn't be right for us to be setting aside the work of teaching and the work of prayer to be spending time either preparing or delivering the meals. Did someone need to deliver the meals? The answer is yes. They even need to be godly men because there was some friction over the whole thing about whether the meals were being delivered in an orderly way. And so they said, let's find godly men who are of good character and who can take care of this job. So we have a precedent for choosing men to do the work, and we have a precedent for them being assigned to do whatever the needs are that arise in the life of the church. But what kind of qualifications should they have? Let's run through this starting at verse 8. Deacons, likewise, are to be men worthy of respect, that is, honored for their character, affirmed by all the believers. Such a man is to be sincere. It means not double-tongued, that is, not professing one thing and then professing something different, but staying consistent in what is professed, not indulging in much wine, having, again, that proper temperance and be giving a godly example to others, not pursuing dishonest gain. And I want to point out something to you. Deacons are frequently given charge over financial and valuable things in the life of the church. Did you understand this? It should not be that such a deacon is given to dishonest use of funding or finances or resources. That would be entirely inappropriate. Such a one should hold the deep truths of the faith. We note that deacons nowhere are described as being the ones who are teaching. The elders have been assigned to be the ones who are the primary teachers. Once again, I'm not saying that we cannot learn from one another. We all, in some ways, have ways that we learn from each other, but the elders are asked to be the ones who are guarding over the message of the church and teaching. The deacons, however, are asked to do this, to hold the deep truths of the faith. That is, that it is their job to completely be solid in their own faith, not shaken, not half-hearted about such things. They are to be tested in verse 10. To be tested. You allow time to see a man in action over an extended season, see how he does during difficult times in his own life, and you don't assume that you know a man too quickly. Have you ever had an opportunity to see somebody and say, wow, that guy's just really on fire for the Lord, and some months later you say, what happened? Have you ever seen that? I have. The Lord would say to Timothy a little later, in the same book, he says, don't lay your hands on and share in the ministry with people too quickly. Give time to see what their character is over a little bit of time. And that's a point of wisdom. So here it says he should be tested. And if after an appropriate period of trial, there's nothing unfavorable, let him serve. What's more, verse 11, it says in the same way their wives are to be women worthy of respect, not malicious talkers, but temperate, trustworthy in everything. Obviously, if he has difficulty with his wife and her character, his first role would be to be ministering to her rather than be ministering to others. But also I have something else to say about this, and this is something that I need you all to understand. Those who are elders and those who are deacons are frequently involved with the neediest ones in the church. Let us picture this situation. A certain deacon is asked by the elders, would you take this check that is a benevolence check and go and deliver it to this home and find out what their needs are. It appears to us that something's gone really wrong there, and something may come apart, and we may want to bring some food right now, and we may want to check back with them soon. Would you assess the situation? The deacon thinks about it and says, you know, that family has their wife and the girls there who may need somebody to talk to them about all this. I'm going to bring my wife along, which I think may be a good idea. He and his wife go there. They deliver some things. They find out what the needs are. The two women talk heart to heart. They come home again, and they say to each other, there's a real need here. We must pray for these people. If his wife is a malicious talker, if his wife is somebody who is indiscreet about how she ministers to others, this is not going to go well. Did you understand that? Soon, we're going to find that what was meant to be a sensitive matter handled carefully by the church was no longer that. And so we're understanding, a husband and a wife, God has created them to be one. God has created them to be able to minister together. God has created them to be in such a way where the one is not undermining the ministry of the other. Do you get this? So, we've put down that we have trustworthy wives. And two more things. He is to be the husband of but one wife. He's to be faithful as a one-woman man. And finally, he's to manage his children and household well. This is his primary duty. And if this is not doing well, if this is suffering, he doesn't need other duties. He is to manage his children and his household well. The Bible next tells us, those who, and I'm in verse 13, those who have served well gain an excellent standing and great assurance in their faith in Christ Jesus. I have something to say to you all. In our church, there may be several qualities we have, but one of them that I hold very dearly is that virtually every one of you who have any maturity in Christ, any regularity in fellowshipping with us, virtually every one of you have areas of service in the body of Christ. Is this true? It is not my intention to say we will name three or four deacons and we will have them scurrying around and doing everything, but instead to say we all are serving in some way. Is this right? There may be some who are uniquely called to do something that is more or more sensitive, but all of us are called to serve. And it says those who serve, and this should be you, those who serve, verse 13, have two things that happen in their lives. The first is that they gain an excellent standing, it says. An excellent standing in what way? I would say a position of honor in God's sight. When you are serving the Lord, and many of you are serving the Lord in ways that I know nothing about. That's the sweet thing about our church. I will hear months later, so-and-so came over to so-and-so's house and helped and served in these ways. I knew nothing about it. It was the Spirit of God that sent you, and you served. The Bible says God honors and rewards this, and you will receive His reward for such service. Did you understand this? It doesn't matter what others know or think about this. In fact, God says so much the better if they don't all know about it. But you will gain an excellent standing, honor, position of honor in God's sight. God gives eternal reward and position to those who serve Him, and that is not a small thing. Secondly, those who serve gain great assurance in their faith in Jesus Christ. I'll tell you why. Anyone can do some thankless behind-the-scenes job for a week or two. No one continues with a thankless behind-the-scenes job for year after year unless it's the Holy Spirit empowering you to do it. And if the Holy Spirit is empowering you to do that, that is assurance that you are in the faith. It may not be the only form of insurance, but God says this is great assurance. If you're able to faithfully, loyally serve behind the scenes when no one knows, no one cares, no one thanks you, and it's hard, and you continue to do it, and you have a joy in doing it, and you say, that was great, I'm ready to do that again next time, that is from God. And it says, those who serve gain this. Now, I'm going to tell you something. The instructions we've covered so far in this chapter are enormously practical. When the Apostle Paul wrote to Timothy in this book, he said, you need to put biblically qualified elders and deacons in place. Then a couple books later in Titus, he writes to Titus, and he says the same thing. We need qualified elders and deacons. The church will suffer without them. Without qualified elders and deacons, the church will suffer. And the church will suffer if the wrong men are chosen. if they are chosen in such a way where they themselves say, oh, I like the title, I like the influence, I like the honor, I like the personal satisfaction, it will all be human and it will all be wrong. It has to be God's work. And so as we've already pointed out, and we'll point out again, entrusting God's work to ungodly men will yield ungodly results. But we're not done with the message. There's part three. Now, verse 18, it says 14. Although I hope to come to you soon, Paul says, I am writing you these instructions so that if I am delayed, you will know how people ought to conduct themselves in God's household, which is the church of the living God, the pillar and the foundation of the truth. The Apostle Paul now reminds Timothy about why he's writing these instructions, why he's writing instructions about elders, why he's writing instructions about deacons, why he's writing instructions about everything found in this book. He says, the reason I'm doing this is I would like to come and talk to you face to face, but it may be a while. Firstly, I am thankful. Listen, I am thankful that he wrote these things down. If it was all communicated orally, I wouldn't have this information, so I'm glad. But also, and this is important, he says, I will get to you sometime, but I'm writing these to you now so that you can implement these without delay. And you might say, well, why so urgent? Why is it so urgent that we need to have all of this done? Because the church itself is of such immense value that it must be viewed not merely as a human institution, but as something holy that God created for a purpose. And Paul outlines with metaphors three of those kind of purposes or visions of what God sees. Let's take a look here again at verse 15. He says, if I'm delayed, you're going to know how people ought to conduct themselves in God's household. That's the first of these. Is everyone listening? In God's household, he says, and he's using the terminology of a family, of a household, and he says, the church of God is like a household. Does God take children and put them in homes where there's wise parents who care for them and they have food to eat and they have safe beds to sleep in and there's things that are meant to be happening to conduct a good and wholesome household? Is that what God does for children generally? Yes. Yes. We feel very saddened when we hear about the orphan, the street child, somebody who hasn't got that. Is this true? God says that his church is his household. We, as his children, have a family of believers. We are to be interacting with one another there, and this is a safe place where we are fed and we are cared for. And he says, this is a good thing. It's like a family. It's like a household. God says, I think of it this highly. Now, I would not, under any situation, say, let's throw a bunch of kids together, hope for the best, and not give any parental leadership or have any kind of guidance in the home. Is that right? I think you all meant the same thing when you said both yes and no, because I asked the question in a confusing way. But the answer is we wouldn't do that. God says in his household, which is the church, we're not going to throw a lot of people together and have no guidance, no direction, no leadership in that body. He says, we're not going to do that. This is my household. Everybody got this so far? But he says, I've got another analogy for you. The next words, it is the church of the living God. It's a place where the living God, through the Holy Spirit, dwells. It's being set up as being a kind of a parallel to the temple in the Old Testament, where God would say, I dwell there. Now, I understand. Listen, in a very real way, what God says is his Holy Spirit finds a dwelling place in the life or the heart of the individual Christian. Isn't this right? But then he goes on to say in other places that there's something unique about God's presence where several come together in agreement in worship and prayer. Do you know that? It becomes a place of God's presence when that takes place. God, in the Old Testament, when he said, I'm going to come and dwell here, he designated certain ones to function as priests and other things to facilitate the work that he was doing. And God does something similar today. He says, I want to dwell in my church, and I'm designating different ones to have a role in that. Let's not neglect this. And then a third analogy, I'm still here in verse 15, after the church of the living God, he says, it's the pillar and foundation of the truth. The church has been given the truth, which it must now proclaim. And if it itself is on a sturdy foundation, then it may proclaim it and lift it very high. The idea about pillars, do you see my pillars here? Why were pillars used in ancient times? And I'll tell you why. Because out of sticks and stuff, you could build a house that was about this tall. You wouldn't want to build a house out of sticks and things that was, you know, a 10-story house because something bad would happen. So the houses were relatively small, but then if you wanted to take something and lift it way up high where everyone could see, you'd use pillars and you'd put the building and the roof very high. The Church of Jesus Christ is God's plan for lifting his truth up very high. Did you understand this? That's his plan. I realize that there are other things out there. People say, well, maybe through radio we can broadcast his truth, and on the internet we can broadcast his truth, and through people traveling to foreign countries and doing mime we can share his truth, and lots of things, and I'm not opposed to any of them. Sherwood, did you do mime overseas? He did. See, I'm not making this up. But God says his number one plan, the key that he has for this, is for the Church of Jesus Christ in all of its beauty, with all of its truth, with all of its purity, to be lifted very high, to be shining forth his truth the way that a tall building would be lifted up on pillars. Do you get this? This is really fantastic. Such a mission of the church being the one to proclaim truth and lift that truth high is in keeping with the work of Christ, which he began and which the church continues now as itself being the body of Christ, as the hands and feet of Christ today. Now, this is hard for many to understand. In fact, the last verse of this chapter says it's something of a mystery to many. But it's nevertheless a great truth. Let's see this truth. Beyond all question, verse 16, the mystery of godliness is great. He appeared in a body, was vindicated by the Spirit, was seen by angels, was preached among the nations, was believed on in the world, was taken up into glory. What is this saying? Jesus Christ! Jesus appeared in his body. You know that. He was vindicated by the Spirit, meaning more than anything else, when the world said that Jesus was worthy of death, the Spirit of God vindicated him by raising him to life. Do you understand this so far? He was seen by angels at the resurrection itself. And other times, he was preached among the nations, first by the apostles and then by their successors. He was believed on in the world. There became a worldwide mission for the Church of Jesus Christ to get the message of Jesus everywhere, and was taken up into glory, leaving the church to complete the task of reaching the world with the gospel. You got this? The church's mission, then, is to bring the gospel of Jesus Christ to the world. I want to make this as clear as I can. We're nearing the end. God's plan for salvation is Jesus Christ. God's plan for missions is the church. Did you all catch that again? God's plan for salvation is Jesus Christ. No one gets saved because of the church. In that sense, the church did not die to save anyone. God's plan for salvation is Jesus Christ. God's plan for missions is the church. The church is God's beautiful creation. And so since it is beautiful and since it is God's plan, it is under attack. And it's under attack in many different ways, but I'm going to just share this. Just in terms of how people think. These days, it's common to say, oh, the church. You know, I'm not really into that kind of organized stuff. I don't really care for getting too connected to any one kind of organization. I'm kind of a free spirit. I think my own way. I'm going to have my own way of doing things. Yes, I care about Jesus, but not the church. No, no thanks. Not that for me. Have you heard this? I have. Satan would love to whisper that to people because Jesus says, I care about the church so much. This is my plan. And to get people to say, no, I'm, you know, it's sort of like, you know, eating your vegetables. Who would want that? I mean, you know, they would say this, and I would say, Jesus says this is beautiful and wonderful. Now, some people will say, well, I'll tell you why I feel this way. I know of a church. In fact, I even was part of a church at one time, and they did bad things, and it was awful. Can I ask you this? Have you ever heard in the past of marriages that have been really bad? Have you ever heard of something like that? Does that mean that God wants us to throw out the possibility of marriage in our lives? Have you ever heard of churches that did really bad things? Does that mean that it's God's desire for us to throw out his beautiful creation of the church? The answer is no. It does mean that God would want us to wisely choose leaders and to stay in step with him. But he says the church is wonderful. And that brings me to something else, the way that not only is the church under attack, but the idea of leadership within the church is under attack. I don't want people telling me what to do. I think we all should be free to do whatever we want. In fact, I think if there are leaders in the church, they should facilitate us all doing whatever we want, someone may say. And they might even say the reason they think that is they've known of leaders who have done bad things. And I will ask you again, the fact that some leaders somewhere have done bad things, does that mean that God does not care for us to have elders or pastoral guidance in the church? The answer is no. He says this is going to be a good thing. He wants this. What he would ask us to do is not to throw out the concept, but instead to be very, very careful about how leaders are chosen and how they will live according to God's standards. There would be something very careful we'd want to do. To come back to our point again, entrusting God's work to ungodly men will yield ungodly results. I will say one last thing as we finish now. This is something that is not overtly said in this text, but something I can tell you is said elsewhere in the Scriptures and is something that needs to be said at the end of a message like this. It is right for believers, it is right for a church to pray for the pastor and elders of a church. All of us, every one of us, are under attack from Satan. The Bible tells us so. All of us have the capacity to come into real difficulty in our lives if we don't keep our eyes on Christ. Is that true? That's true for every one of us. I am grateful for the elders of this church. I'm grateful for the people of this church. I would be very thankful if you would be in prayer for me and for Mr. Kalis and Mr. Hoppy and Mr. Hunt. I can tell you that each year, in recent years anyway, our family usually somewhere about this time will put out a little card and it shows a picture of our family. And what we put on it isn't Merry Christmas, although I'm glad to greet you this way, but we put on it, please pray for the Manwiller family in 2015. The need to pray for those who serve in this way is great. And I would implore you to do that. You will get a card like that, and I will tell you why you don't have one yet. And this is a complete aside, it's not in my notes. But we held off the picture until a baby came, and the baby delayed. But please pray for those who are in this position and seek for yourself to grow into the kind of maturity that would make you qualified to serve in the body of Christ as well. These are beautiful things I'm sharing with you today. And we're going to end our message with a word of prayer and then a concluding song. Our Lord Jesus, you've woven a number of things together in this, and I appreciate what Mr. Kissling said. Our eyes oughtn't to be on us, but on you. And as we look at you, then you give us care and compassion and love for others. And I pray that you would give us that care for those in the body of Christ, and similar care for those who do not know you, who are well beyond the body of Christ, so that they may also be reached for Jesus. We pray for those who serve now, and we ask that you would be raising to maturity those who would serve in the future. I think even right now, of the room full of children who are here, that they would grow in Christian maturity and in stature and wisdom such that they would be used by you for a generation to come. That as you amass the troops here, that you would send them forth to do your great work in the world in the generation ahead. We thank you that we can hear these things from your word. And we offer our lives to your service in your name, O Christ. Amen.